The Employers Confederation of the Philippines sees a number of challenges once some workers return to work beginning Saturday when many parts of the country relax lockdown protocols. Let's talk now to ECO President Sergio Ortiz Luis Jr. about restarting the economy and reopening businesses against a backdrop of a health crisis. Hi, sir. Good afternoon.
Hi. Good afternoon, Ron.
Now, do you agree with the government's move under a modified ECQ to open up more businesses? And do you agree as well with the timing? Not too early, not premature?
Oh, definitely. Any improvement moving away from a total lockout is an improvement. Unfortunately, I don't think we expect too many working people to be working on tomorrow. Because I think the groundwork has not been prepared, no? Number one, 90% of these companies are small ones, micro, and they're having difficulty whether they will deciding whether they will start or not. And plus the fact that those who would like to start, they are supposed to do only about 50% workers. And we just learned that no public transportation will be allowed, mm-hmm. and only those who will be able to provide shuttle service will be allowed. And the ones who can afford that will be very few out of the companies. And even that will have a problem because how will they cross the shuttle? Who will drive? Do they need passes? Or if they need passes, who is going to issue them? And right. What are the rules if you're working if you live in Quezon City and you're working in Makati, will you be able to go to work? So the problem is, having said that these companies can open now, the excitement will be from the workers who are really, after all this time, would like to work. And they would just go out on the streets and or walk or even find a way to get to their office only to find out they're not open yet or mm-hmm. the factories aren't open yet. Because my expectation is those who can afford to open their offices now and they're willing will probably send a few people to arrange the tables for the distancing. To arrange who are going to come in, who will be advised that they will be working, and in factories it's worse because I don't know how they're going to arrange it so that you get the social distancing that you have, and plus remember 80% of these offices are closed, so when they go there tomorrow, it's probably just to decide on some basic things, right? Open the office. And decide they will get the necessary implements like the mask, the vitamins that they are supposed to offer. Or even worse is that if they are required, it's not yet very clear whether they will have to house their employees in their compound, where I don't think they have the capacity to do so, or to rent spaces beside the company so that they will not have to be traveling or back and forth. So I don't expect it's a waste because, you know, about 500,000 people, if we prepare for this, 500,000 is the 500,000 less people that the government have to support if they can start working. And that is a pity because sayang. Sayang yung opportunity na i-prepare sana lahat ito.
But sir, this could provide the transition. By tomorrow, a lot of these companies and employers and employees will be finding out the initial problems of transitioning even with a 50% workforce, even if it's not going to be a 50% workforce going to work. But they will find out the problems and they may be able to adjust. Are you thinking that this could improve in the coming days or maybe weeks?
Oh, definitely. Like for instance, when we were locked out the first day that we had the locked out, there was a lot of problems. You know how the how people going back to their houses from the province weren't able to come back. But it took a lot of time to be able to do this. And you're right, this can be a trial, but this will be a long trial, in, as I said, it's a wish. For instance, even now, under the ECQ, a lot of passes has been issued for those who are exempted to be able to work there, exporters, those who are in outdoors in food, those on services, tracking or things like those. They're still having a problem, and sometimes the drivers don't even get the license. Initially, it was IAEF passes. Now they have the rapid pass issued by the ITC. Sometimes it takes weeks to be able to get it. And when you follow up, nobody even is bothered. That is why we're saying, you know, it's a pity that they took away the ease of doing business responsibility from the implementers. They have to put it back so that there will be sense of urgency to those who are implementers of whatever it is, especially when we're trying to open up the business again. There have to be some sense of urgency and with the people who are implementing it.
Do you think the government consulted the private sector enough for this transition to modified ECQ and even to GCQ? You mentioned a lot of problems, transportation, not a lot of people are going to work, not just because of transportation, but the difficulty in opening up, and as well as a problem in the transport of goods. Wasn't the public sector, private sector, I mean, consulted about this? And were you given a chance to raise these issues before making that transition?
Well, you know how it is. The IATF meet, and they make decisions, and sometimes it's a trial balloon to us. We react to it, but most of the time we don't even know what happened. Look at the issue of the senior citizen. Until now, it's not settled. We don't understand what is still trying to do on that. No, so I think that's why we were saying using private sector here. Even I think the issue of the transportation is not decided because they don't know what to do. I think that's the problem. They cannot. I think there is some expert in the private sector who should be able to help them. They consult them. So you know, it's not the forte of the Department of Health to arrange for transportation and to arrange neither of the ITs of the you know. I think private sector should have been, you know, we have been saying that they should be consulting. There's a lot of private sector people they can use.
Mm-hmm. Now, you mentioned this a while ago. You said that for safety reasons, of course, employers should be the one providing first transportation for their employees. But you also want them to supply the face masks and even PPEs for some and the vitamins for their own employees. Should this be mandatory for private companies who are planning to open up shop?
It's not a problem for the medium and large ones, but there are very few. As I said, 99.6% of the companies are micro, small, and medium. Right. And the micro is 90%. And certainly, they already have a problem with the lack of cost. And if you pass it on to them, they have a problem. They even have a problem now with the regulation that that Trump came out. We are not clear. For instance, they say that if somebody gets sick, the responsibility, if they're not paid by SSS or PhilHealth, the company will pay for it. That's probably, but you know, people are delayed. Maybe they give them free time, and the companies are delayed in paying. So it might be a reason. The other thing is, it's not very clear whether if you fail to give vitamins or and some people get sick there or plasmas or whatever is necessary, or testing. That is not very clear yet, no? Because we're afraid that if you don't test your workers, and many of the companies, the small ones, cannot afford this. And that's why I am saying people, companies should just be watching first before they start. They would like to see how it goes. And you are right. This can be a practice. This can be something that we can. But it's a waste because you could gain 2 weeks of feeding and taking care of people if we already prepare for this. And day one, people can be there already. I mean, 500,000 people employed is 500,000 people that the government should not be taking care of.
Do you see the cost of goods and services rising to catch up with losses, aside from the additional cost of providing these masks and vitamins to their employees and possibly testing?
I did get the first part of your question.
Do you see the cost of goods and services rising, leading to the new normal, to catch up with losses?
Well, definitely, you have to. I think you have to provide the mask, the whatever is necessary testing. It's costly for small ones, but it is much cheaper than giving 5,000, 8,000 to the person. If he starts working, I'd rather that the government pays for this already so that people can start working rather than companies not opening or workers that are being able to work because these are expenses that they can hardly afford at this time.
But aside from that, Mr. Ortiz Luis, in catching up with losses, throughout the lockdown, with operations grinding to a halt, when they reopen, will the costs of services and goods rise?
Oh, definitely. Can you imagine? Even just the transportation of the people, that's an expense. And your market is not there. Maybe you will be operating, but the market that you have available is only 30%. So anybody who opens at this time is definitely will be operating at a loss. For some, whose employees they have to pay monthly, it's not a problem anyway, and that's the bigger one. But for companies which have no work, no pay employees, they will not open because then they will be paying salaries to people who will not be doing any much benefit for the company.
Finally, sir, there is a proposal by government for the cutting of income taxes across the board. Your thoughts on this?
Well, the income tax is good, but that will be in the medium term. At the moment, I don't think anybody will benefit from it because everybody will probably be taking a loss this year.
Okay. Mr. Sergio Ortiz Luis, Jr., the president of the Employers Confederation of the Philippines, we appreciate your thoughts. Thank you once again for talking to us.
Thank you, Dora.